Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us. First, I would like to thank Alison Walton from the Immokalee IFES Center for her help and cooperation. Today's program offers one CEU for pesticide license renewal and one CEU for certified crop advisors. If you need CEUs, email me your name, email address, and license number. As you know, citrus researchers in Florida have been looking for solutions to HLB from many angles. Today's seminar program will focus on CLS or citrus greening and Asian citrus psyllid interferences from basic science to potential innovative control strategies. Our guest speaker is Dr. Nabil Kalini, Associate Professor in Plant Pathology with UF IFES Citrus Research and Education Center in Lake Alfred. Again, Dr. Kalini will talk about the interaction of CLS or HLB and its insect vector, the citrus psyllid, and how that interaction could be a targeted link to mitigate HLB or citrus greening. Dr. Kalini, it's all yours. Please go ahead.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Manji. Thank you for the opportunity you gave it to me to talk about my research in the last 12 years. And I hope what I will present today will give some idea about the effort we are trying for many years to try to solve the HLB. As you mentioned, everybody worked, every researcher, he worked from his point of view, from his in his field, and from his background. So HLB, it's very well known now, and unluckily it just affects the citrus industry severely. And the symptoms, there are some symptoms are common with other diseases like the blotch mottle here, similar to spiroplasma, but other symptoms actually are very important and affect the health of the tree severely, including reduction of the root system and the abnormal looking of the fruits and other symptoms. But the main symptoms is actually the fruit drop. Fruit drop, it happened after the infection with HLB, and this severely affect the number of boxes and the yield. So Honglong Bing is very specific disease in terms of the pathosystem, because there are one more player here in this game. There is a pathogen, Candidates rubacter asiaticus, and by the way, this putative pathogen or putative agent of the disease, it's not really proved yet, but because the bacteria is not available in culture yet. And the host, citrus and citrus relatives. And the third player here is the vector. And this makes the disease and the problem much more complicated, because we have one more layer here is the vector. So insects lay eggs in the new shoots, like you see here, and the eggs hatch into new nymphs, and the nymphs feed a lot actually in the new shoots. During that, the nymphs can acquire the bacteria or inoculate the bacteria in a new host. So after the emerging into adults, the adult can fly to go to another healthy tree to lay eggs or to inject or inoculate the bacteria directly in the new shoots or in the plant. And like that, we have the transmission and the spread of the disease. So the white we see here is the honeydew. Honeydew is a structure of some secretion. The nymph and the adult actually secrete after feeding because the insect feed in the phloem sap, which is rich in sucrose. Sucrose cause hyperosmosity inside the insect body, and the insect have several strategies in to go over this osmosity by secreting the honeydew, which is mainly sugars. So, and here is the life cycle of the insect, eggs and five anisters, and then we have the adult after mating, lay eggs in the new shoots and so on. So, and this is how the bacteria spread in the grooves. Insect transmission, and here is actually very important part of this disease and something we really needed to understand and study very well. Because as I will show in the end, that's actually can direct us to a new strategy to control the disease. And just to keep in mind again, it is vector-borne disease, and vector here is very important, and it's very simple thinking. If we can eradicate, if we can just get rid of all the vector, how come we will have the disease? The pathogen will not be spread, so there are no transmission. So three main stuff here for the insect transmission. First one is persistent. And persistent meaning if the bacteria stay in the insect body its entire life. And actually, yes, our bacteria is persistent. Second is circulation. So the bacteria can circulate after feeding. The bacteria can pass the gut, go to the hemolymph to propagate. And the three together, actually, it is a worst scenario for any vector-borne pathogen, because the insect vector can transmit the pathogen for hundreds of trees, and also the bacteria grow inside the insect all the time. So there are always source for the bacteria. So it's vector, the citrus host, and the pathogen. And unluckily for Hong Longbing, we have the worst scenario because the bacteria is acquired most likely as nymphs, as I explained before, and circulate within the insect, multiply in the insect, and persist. And the persistence here for this bacteria, one more factor is the bacteria can form a biofilm on the gut. And this actually helps the persistence of the bacteria. And here is the two action we really need to interfere with: the acquisition when the nymph acquires the bacteria, and the inoculation when the adult inoculates the pathogen in a new tree. And here is we want really to understand how it's really working. For Candidatus salivator asiaticus transmission by Diaphoreno citri, the Asian citrus psyllid, I mentioned that we have this bacteria form a biofilm, and it's unlike any other bacteria transmitted by insect. All other bacterial pathogens transmitted by insect does not form any biofilm, like phytoplasmas and spiroplasma, except Xylella fastidiosa, which is true bacteria, but this actually is not circulative within the plant, within the insect, and just bind to the foregut. So it is not here even to compare. And the insect can lose the bacteria, by the way, while molting, except the final adult can keep the bacteria for the rest of its life. But back to our system, psyllid, the bacteria form biofilm on the gut, circulate and propagate. Let's talk first about the biofilm and what we found for this part. In order to have a biofilm from any bacteria, the bacteria should have a quorum sensing system. And our bacteria has a two-component system, one of the very well known and studied in the bacteria. If we look at the insect body, here is, for example, the hemolymph. We can see the bacteria grow very nicely, and there are a lot of bacteria in the hemolymph compared to the healthy. If we do in situ hybridization to the surface of the dissected gut from infected, we can see here the bacteria. There are a fluorescence, which means that the bacteria form a biofilm. With electron microscope, we can see the biofilm very easily here. So here is actually how it's really working. Okay, but in order to have a biofilm inside the gut from outside, from the side of hemolymph, the bacteria need first to go through the midgut, the epithelial cells, and to go out to the hemolymph. And this happens by endocytosis and exocytosis. Inside the hemolymph, the bacteria grow, but also form a biofilm. And then go to the salivary glands. And once the bacteria colonize the salivary glands, the insect can transmit, can inoculate the bacteria in new plants. Back to the system. So it is two component system, LOXR and homoserine lecton. LOXR is a protein, homoserine lecton is a compound. So what we see here, that when we have, after having the bacteria, after the insect acquires the bacteria and the bacteria go through the gut to be in the hemolymph, the bacteria start to grow. While growing, the bacteria produce the homoserine lecton and diffuses these molecules in the hemolymph. So the molecules are secreted in the hemolymph. After multiplication and the high density of bacterial cells, the bacteria start to reacquire this homoserine lecton. Homoserine lecton bind to the protein LOXR, and the complex trigger the expression of genes implicated in biofilm formation, and like that we can start to have a biofilm formation on the surface of gut. And here actually it's very important to say that in the genome we found that our bacteria has the protein LOXR, but doesn't have LOXI, which is the gene produce the homoserine lecton. And to explain that, I need to tell you that for acyl homoserine lecton bacteria system, there are two kinds of bacteria. There are bacteria produces the homoserine lecton besides the LOXR, and there are other bacteria like ours does not produce the homoserine lecton, but has only the LOXR protein. First kind of bacteria, so it produces the homoserine lecton and get it back, and the complex triggers the biofilm formation. However, this bacteria also can acquire foreign homoserine lecton. Now, for the non-producer of homoserine lecton, the bacteria can acquire the homoserine lecton from the secreted and from other bacteria, so the foreign homoserine lecton, or eukaryotic signals. And both can do the job and express or trigger the expression. However, as you can see here, with the homoserine lecton from other bacteria, and the complex triggers the biofilm formation. But with eukaryotic signal, the complex does not trigger the biofilm formation, but it just triggers the motility of the bacteria and the growth. So here, when we have our LOXR from our bacteria expressed in E. coli, with GFB, and grows his media in different kind of homoserine lactone. As you can see, we can actually have a signal, which means that the LuxR from CLAS is active. But it's very interesting here that also the extract from plant. So both extract from insect and extract from plant, we can see the fluorescence. That means there are molecules in plant also can bind to the LuxR of CLAS. But when we do some specific work here, like extract the homoserine lactone from insect healthy or infected and plant healthy or infected, we can detect only if we do this actually thin layer chromatography and we lay this plate with bacteria called Agrobacterium tumefaciens, and this one has a biosensor for the homoserine lactone. So we can detect only homoserine in insect, but in plant, nothing. So in this case, and according to what I said before, so inside the insect, our bacteria can acquire homoserine lactone. There are homoserine lactone produced by other bacteria, endosymbiont, and the bacteria can acquire it, and then there are forming for the biofilm because the true complex is complete. But inside the plant, and as I mentioned here, that homoserine lactone can bind to eukaryotic signal. And this is exactly what we found, that with indole acetic acid and GABA in citrus plant can bind to the LuxR from the bacteria. But as I mentioned also that this complex does not trigger the expression of biofilm, it just triggers the mobility and motility of the bacteria. So the bacteria can move more. Now, how it's really working? Here, what I think. Inside the insect, there are endosymbiotic bacteria which produce and secrete homoserine lactone in the hemolymph. Candidiasis bacteria asiaticus can acquire this secreted homoserine lactone, and the complex triggers the biofilm formation, so we can see biofilm formation in an insect. And this can make the bacteria persistent the whole life of the cell. While in plant, the bacteria can bind to other signals, eukaryotic signals, which in our case is indole acetic acid and GABA. And this triggers a multiplication and the planktonic status, which is also very important for the bacteria inside the plant to be movable and to colonize the whole plant. So the bacteria can move within the plant easily, then binding and having biofilm. The insect body is very limited, very small. And because the insect feed a lot and there are secretion of honeydew, so the bacteria need to protect itself to be attached to the gut in order to be there forever. So the biofilm formation is a good idea for the bacteria inside the insect, but bad idea inside the plant. So we followed that by using CTV to express LuxR inside the plant. And it's very interesting that we start to see more symptoms inside the plant after expressing of LuxR. So I can say that the free LuxR produced by the CTV bind to the signal, indole acetic acid and GABA, and this makes the bacteria more movable. So we can see the symptoms and more multiplicative. So we can see the symptoms much more, like here in two different plants in Citrus microphylla and also in Valencia sweet orange. However, if we catch infected psyllid on these plants, we notice that there are a reduction of the infection rate, which means the bacteria, the insect lose the bacteria. And here I can actually explain by after the insect acquires the LuxR, LuxR bind to the free homoserine lactone inside the hemolymph of body, hemolymph of insect. The hemolymph of insect is the blood of insect. So inside the hemolymph and prevent the bacteria of acquiring the homoserine lactone. So this reduces the chance of having the biofilm, and this actually can reduce the population of the bacteria inside the insect and can actually cure the insect from the bacteria. Okay, now let's do the other way, is to express homoserine lactone, acyl homoserine lactone in bacteria, in plant, in citrus, using also LOX CTV. And this here, there are three kind of homoserine lactone we expressed in the citrus. One of them, as you can see, we start to have a very limited phenotype. So the symptoms start to be very limited to some places, to some branches in the tree. So let's here see how it's really working. Here is the healthy, here is the infected. So the normal infected with CLS, we can see symptoms here and there, but it's not very heavy. But if we express LOX-R, we can see almost equal distribution of symptoms everywhere, simply because we made the bacteria more movable. And when we added homoserine lactone, what happened here, the homoserine lactone can limit the bacteria movement. So if the bacteria inside the plant acquire homoserine lactone, it could make biofilm and could limit the bacteria in certain branches. And the idea here, if we can do that, we can actually just cut these branches full of bacteria, and the other, the rest of the tree will be free, bacterial free. We're still working on that, and hopefully we can find more interesting and more promising information about that. Now, back to the transmission. We talked about the biofilm formation. Now let's talk about the circulation. The bacteria, in order for the bacteria to circulate within the insect body, the bacteria need to pass the biological barriers, including the gut and the salivary glands. And this needs very specific interaction, receptors, ligands. And this actually can be protein-protein interaction. We didn't guess, there are many systems has investigated, including phytoplasmas, spiroplasma, which has a very similar method, a very similar mode of transmission, except just you don't form a biofilm. And we start to look at these proteins. So after acquiring the bacteria inside the gut, the bacteria need to go from the gut to the hemolymph. Inside the hemolymph, the bacteria can multiply, and also the bacteria can form a biofilm, but also the free cells of bacteria can go and colonize the salivary glands. And while feeding in a new plant, the insect inoculate the bacteria. Again, here is the biofilm, and here is the free cells. So the free cells can go to the salivary gland. But in order to, for the bacteria to pass the gut and to get in, inside the salivary glands, there are very specific interactions. We need to look at these specific interactions. Well, there are a technique called Farwester. Simply, we have the proteins of the insect plotted in membrane after electrophoresis, and we cover this membrane with antibody against with phloem sap infected with the bacteria. And after washing, we can detect the complexes. And the complexes, by we got these spots, these proteins, and identify with LC-MS, we can know what are the receptors inside the insects, which proteins of the insects bind to the bacteria. And here you can see ATP synthase, ATP alpha and beta subunit, actin, tubulin, and ATPase, glucose regulated protein, and arginine kinase. All of that actually are implicated in the energy and implicated in the structure, actin and tubulin. But the rest of the of proteins are implicated in the energy, which actually give us an idea about maybe the bacteria manipulate the insect in order to get energy. And third part here for the transmission, in order to have a successful transmission, the bacteria should propagate, should multiply. And in order to grow, the bacteria need nutrition. Bacteria are located inside the hemocoel, inside the hemolymph, the blood of insect. So it needs to have a nutrition. And we assume that the hemolymph is nutrient for the bacteria. For that, we start to look at the differences after colonizing the bacteria with the colonizing the insect with the bacteria, and see the differences and see how the bacteria manipulate that, how the what kind of compounds here are increased or decreased after the infection of the bacteria. The table have a lot of compounds, but what I wanted to just say here that it seems that the bacteria manipulate the TCA cycle. TCA cycle is very important. It's located in the mitochondria, and TCA cycle very important to produce some organic acid like malic acid and citric acid, but also to produce energy. And here actually first indication that the bacteria manipulate the insect for energy. But also here indication and the confirmation that the insect affects the TCA cycle, because the enhanced TCA cycle causes more respiration, and we can monitor that with the infected cell. You can see the infected cell respire much more. There are much more CO2 produced by the insect if it is infected with the bacteria than the healthy one. But we also looked at the nymph. As I mentioned, nymph feed a lot and can acquire the bacteria, and most likely the transmission start from the nymph. Nymph acquires the bacteria grow, make biofilm, and after emerging into adult, the adult have the capacity to fly and then can inoculate the bacteria. Here, just to show that here are the feeding of the nymphs are much higher than the adult. And when we see, we compare the effect, no, the effect is much more in the after the infestation with the nymphs, which means that the nymph really manipulate the insect metabolism in the same way, almost like the adult. However, the effect is huge in compared to the adult. Something here, just it's very important. We found that citric acid and malic acid increase, which show that the bacteria maybe enhances the TCA cycle inside the plant, the insect, in order to accumulate citric acid and malic acid, which is the bacteria use it as a carbon source. So, and this is very known. For the bacteria, in order to grow, it needs carbon source, and most likely it's organic acid. And here it's just very nice demonstration that our bacteria use the citric and malic acid from the insect. But that's actually cause energetic stress inside the insect, as we showed that the respiration increased. And energy, so we need to think also about the ATP, ADP, and the energetic nucleotide. Why? Because the bacteria has ATP translocase, and it has been shown that the protein is active, the enzyme is active, and also showed when we express it in E. coli, it can acquire ATP, ADP, and AMP from the media. So here we just show that the ATP content inside the insect, inside the infected cell with the bacteria is much higher. However, the ATPase activity of the insect is reduced. So it seems that, very simple, the bacteria induce the insect to produce much more ATP for its own benefit, but prevent the insect itself of using it. And we can see that in details when we look at the ratios AMP to ATP and so on. Here is actually something very important, something called adenylated energy charge. And we calculate it from the amount of ATP, AMP, and ADP. And when we have higher amount, higher rate of the adenylated energy charge, that means that the organism is actually has a shorter lifespan compared to the one with less ratio of the adenylated. Or in other words, accumulation of ATP, a lot of amount of ATP inside the cells, kills the cells. And this is exactly what we found, that the insect has shorter lifespan here, shorter lifespan, but also the survival, you can see death every day more than the healthy cell. When we look at the gene expression for genes, it's very, very nice. We can see that the AT basis of the insect, which indicate that the insect use the ATP, is downregulated. So the bacteria doesn't allow the insect to use it. However, the synthase is much higher to produce more ATP to be available for the bacteria. And when we look at the feeding behavior, we found that the infected cell actually feed much more and doesn't probe so much. So shorter time of probing, meaning that the bacteria feel hungry and start to feed a lot. So there are hunger, the bacteria is very hungry, although it has a lot of ATP. And here is actually what just I think how it works, reduction of the ATP base activity. So the insect does not produce the ATP, while ATP synthesis is increased. And that's actually increase the adenylated charge, which lead in the end by shorter lifespan. But the insect try to compensate by using NADPK, which is a nucleotide diphosphate kinase, in order to produce back some ADP from the ATP to make a recycling. And also the AMPK get reduced. And this actually meaning that there are more GDP than GTP, which could be used instead of ATP. So the bacteria really manipulate the ATP energy. And here is just using some microsensors created for our insect, by the way, and to look at the pH with accumulation of ATP. Usually we have higher pH and the hemolymph. And with the enhanced ATC cycle, we also have more respiration, which means less available oxygen inside the hemolymph. So how it's really working here? Here the hemolymph, the bacteria grow inside the hemolymph. Here is the epithelial cells of the gut. The bacteria may be send signals. These signals induce the TCA cycle to produce ATP and to produce citric acid and to produce malic acid. Those get secreted to the hemolymph, and the bacteria use it for carbon source and energy. However, the bacteria also, while growth, the bacteria produce many metabolites, and these metabolites can increase the pH, in addition to the accumulation of the ATP. And the respiration of the bacteria and the respiration from the enhanced TCA inside the insect cells, that's actually decrease the amount of oxygen. And this is how it's really working. And as a result of all of that, there are hyper respiration and there are higher adenylated energy charge and we have shorter lifespan. Last piece here is the fatty acid. So I don't need to tell all of that, but just you can see that most of fatty acid is much less in the infected compared to the healthy cell. And when we look at the total free fatty acid in the hemolymph, much less. When we look at the beta oxidation, Beta oxidation is a mechanism where the organism can break down some fatty acid in order to produce energy, in order to produce ATP. So we found that the beta oxidation, it's really increased a lot. And when we look at the fat body, and we can see here is the healthy and here is the infected hemolymph, you can see much less of the fat granules. And here is much higher in the healthy. This actually meaning that the insect, the presence of the bacteria increase the beta oxidation of the fatty acid. Just to remind you, what is the beta oxidation? Beta oxidation, it happens also in the mitochondria, and the degradation of fatty acids in the end produce ATP. So there are also accumulation of ATP. So if we put here the insect with the infected bacteria, fatty acid in the media usually is toxic to bacteria. So by beta oxidation reduces the free fatty acid, so it's less toxic, so the bacteria can grow better. More ATP, so the bacteria has the energy to grow. And also because it got into the TCA cycle, there are also accumulation of the carbon source, citric and malic acid. So the whole mechanism, it just lead to more growth of the bacteria and less or shorter lifespan of the insect. Now, if we look at the biology, I mentioned that the infected psyllid actually has shorter lifespan. However, it has much more eggs. This is very known in insect when it feel under stress, life is shorter, so the insect lay much more eggs. And you can think about it, more eggs, more population, more transmission, more spread. So still the bacteria actually can manipulate its own spread by the insect. Let's now put everything together. So as I mentioned, the growth of the bacteria will increase the pH, will increase the ATP. ATPase inside the insect will be less, higher respiration inside the insect. TCA cycle is enhanced for the malic and citric acid. So we have the adenylated energy charge increase. There are continuous hunger. So continuous hunger, so there are much more feeding. Also, the stress leads the insect to lay much more eggs. And also the stress, more stress, that actually make aging, and the aging make the lifespan shorter. Not only that, actually, also the adenylated charge, when it's high, usually we have a higher flight capacity. The insect can fly more. And also this for the spread of the bacteria. So it seems that everything changes inside the insect, it just for the benefit of the bacteria, for the spread of the disease. So now, how we can use that for an innovative method to control the disease? We can target the flight capacity. We can target the flight. We can target the aging. We try to make the insect young. So it will be longer, so it will lay much less eggs. We can target the laying eggs, target genes which have something to do with the hatching, for example, or producing the embryonic development, and also feeding. We can interfere with the feeding. If we can interfere with that, we can actually do reduce the transmission. And also we can look at the bacteria with the interaction with the insect. Here, for example, the bacterial growth, we can interfere with its growth. We can also interfere with the bacteria circulation with the specific receptors. But here actually it's a very important figure in my opinion. We showed that acquisition starts in the nymph, and most likely this is the active one. Most likely how the transmission happens is if the insect acquires the bacteria as a nymph. So we need to target the nymph. And if we target the nymph, we can also target the development of the nymphs. How we can target that? We can actually use RNA interference. RNA interference, if you know the central dogma, we have gene. the gene transcription gene gave a messenger RNA, and the messenger RNA, there are translation to protein. RNA interference, very simply, it just if we add more pieces of messenger RNA, but small pieces, these small pieces can go and bind to the messenger RNA and block the translation to protein. So like that, we can reduce the expression. Something here very important, plant. If we do RNA interference in plant, there are a secondary RNA interference, also in nematode and in human. But what that mean? That mean we need to introduce the small RNA or the double-stranded RNA only once. That's it. In plant, no, there are no secondary. So adult is not really a good target if we want to do RNAi. And here again, it's NEMFs. So we need to develop methods to deliver the double-stranded RNA to the insect. And here is the NEMF, and it is the NEMF have the long stylet which go inside the blend and start to suck the phloem sap. And during having this phloem sap, the insect can have the bacteria inside in. We developed this method. You can see here we bought a droplet. It's very small, by the way. It's 0.2 microliter of solution having the double-stranded RNA. Why we developed this, not artificial diet like people use, like parafilm, and we bought the double-stranded RNA? Because we can see the insect can have the whole amount we gave it to the nymph. So we know exactly how much amount of double-stranded RNA we deliver to the nymph. And here just to show that it is really acquiring by feeding. If we give a dye stain, blue stain to the nymph, and you can see we stained the internal organs, the gut, and even a part of the stylet here with blue, which means that it is feeding. Okay, now we have the method and we have the target. Let's first one we talk about is the food coma. We want, since the insect feed a lot, we can actually make the insect continuously feeding. And like that, we can have our insect just like that. So if the insect that fat cannot move and cannot fly, actually, then this kind of insect cannot fly. It's very heavy. And in addition, it will continue feed. It will continue eat from the phloem sap until it's completely exploded. How this come? I just wanted to tell you the target is sucrose hydrolase. This is the phloem sap, and there are a huge amount of sucrose, and the insect, the nymphs, need to feed and need to deal with the sucrose. Otherwise, it will have a lot of osmosity inside the body. So the insect developed three things to go over the osmotic potential. Number one, in the hydrolysis of sucrose. Number two is to produce oligosaccharide, and this actually is a white thing you see. It's just covered with wax. And number three is to dilute the hemolymph with water by feeding in xylem sap or from other parts of the body. And this by aquaporin. So here, when we target this gene and we make RNAi so much less expression, it affects for sure. As you can see, it affects the survival a lot. We have really very, very effective method here to kill the insect. Look at the adult, how it look like. Look at the nymphs, actually. This one is non-treated or treated with water. And look at the others. Just get eat a lot until get exploded. And even the adult which escaped and emerged from treated nymphs, that's what we can see. And also when we look, there are no production of the of the honeydew simply because the enzyme is not there. So this one thing actually we can find, it increases the nymph mortality, makes the lifespan shorter, and also swollen phenotype, heavy insect cannot fly. How it works, just to make the long story short, the accumulation of sucrose, because sucrose hydrolase is not there, and this increases the hyperosmotic pressure, and the insect try to get the water from the body or feed more in the xylem, but it will feed continuously. And so after that, the insect will feel always hungry and feed a lot, and also feed much more in xylem to reduce the hyperosmotic pressure. And this will, in the end, kill the insects. But here, the insect still have one strategy here to reduce this hyperosmotic. And I said the insect use a protein called aquaporin to get the water from the body. Let's target the aquaporin. Aquaporin, when we knock down aquaporin or reduce the expression, uric acid can be accumulated. So we will not only have all of that, no, we'll have also the insects cannot move. So we targeted. So here is aquaporin only, so it doesn't really affect the survival, affect a little bit the lifespan, but it's not that much. However, together, if we target aquaporin and sucrose hydrolase at the same time, we can have a very good results in killing the insect up to 100%. Here is aquaporin also. When we reduce aquaporin expression, we can see some malformation, which is also cool. So we target the hunger, we target the feeding of xylem, and we stop having the water from the body to reduce the osmosity inside or dilute the hemolymph from the sucrose. One more, if the insect does not fly, we will not have transmission. And this is why the inoculation, the second part of the transmission, is done by the adult. Not necessarily, because the adult can just mate and lay eggs and so. But also, yes, by adult. The inoculation in the second part by the adult. So in order to have these nice wings, there are a protein called abnormal wing disc. And here I want to just tell you that this gene or this protein, it has double functionality. It's structural to make the wings, but also NAD decay and sometime nuclease diphosphate kinase. So also included or implicated in the energy production. Targeted, yeah, so we have malformation. You can see how many malformation here, and you can imagine, do you think this kind of insect can fly? I don't think so. No, does not fly. Another one is the lazy bone. I call it lazy bone. We target the myosin. You know, in order to use our muscles, there are troponin and myosin and different protein working together. And myosin and troponin is very important. And if there are no myosin, troponin will just keep binding to calcium. So it will be kind of calcification, and then the insect cannot fly. Yes, so if we target the myosin, this is what you will see. And then you got the emergent adult, put it in hot plate and do count how many jump until the insect get cooked. So you will find with water or GFB just controls, it's up to 15 jump. But with the insects treated with double send RNA, heavy chain or light chain of myosin, it's much less. Myosin is a big protein, and it's consisted of two subunit. One is light chain, this one, and one is heavy chain, light chain and heavy chain. Yes, it's actually affect the survival. That's very normal, because if the muscles getting calcified, what will have actually even the mating, the insect will have a difficulty growing, moving, walking on the plant or flying. But when we look at the CT scan, we found something very interesting here. You can see this normal insect or the control. With the CT scan, we can see just the skeleton of the insect. Here is the skeleton of the wing. Here is the body. Here is the head. But with treated with double-stranded RNA myosin, heavy or light, we can see this structure. You can see here inside. That's actually, you can see here, this is healthy. You will see it is completely empty from inside because the muscles are not visualized by CT scan unless we add a dye or to stain it. But here, no stain. You can see it's completely empty in the normal or healthy insect. Normal insect, non-treated with double-stranded RNA against myosin. Here we can see the muscles. I here just targeted, and it's very characterized like the flight muscle. That's very important. So actually we target the flight also. And here is sideway. So you can see the flight muscle very nicely. So how come we can see the muscles with the treated, with double-stranded RNA, RNAi, but not in non-treated or control? Simply because there are accumulation of the calcium. Once we have accumulation of the calcium, we can see it. So as you can see, here is the flight muscle. Again, this is from textbook, so you can see the different muscles and you can compare with this one. It is exactly the flight muscle. And this actually is very nice to visualize the flight muscle in tiny insect like that. It's very difficult. But with RNAi against myosin, we could do that. In addition to, and this has how it's really working. It is the accumulation of the calcium. I'm not gonna to go and for the full mechanism, but troponin is saturated with calcium, so we can see the muscle. But biologically, accumulation of the calcium, it is calcification. It's very hard to for the insect to do any biological activity. One more is, why you don't make the whole population male? And here actually we looked so much in the genome of Celid, and we found this transformer, this gene called transformer. It's on if the embryo will be female and off if it will be male. So simply if we target the trap and we make it all off, most likely we'll have the whole next generation only male. And like that will not have progeny after that. We work hard on that. We had some very promising data, but we are still working for that. Now, it's very important here, and I will go only in 2 seconds. Seems that we have something very important, very nice, how we can deliver. We will not get all the insects and feed the insects. That's very hard. So there are actually three methods. Use the CTV. So we can use the CTV to produce double-stranded RNA against the insect. And here, the abnormal wing disc using the CTV. And it's actually effective and working, but the reduction is not so much. Here is when we use the myosin, and you can see in the second generation, the blend look very nice. We cannot see even any second generation if we target the myosin. Second method is using the laser to break down the some of the cuticle, as you can see here. So the cuticle is breaking, and we can spray the double-stranded RNA to be inside the plant, and then the insect can acquire it, and we have the double-stranded RNA. And here just a result of one of those experiments with the laser where we target three different genes, and you can see how the insect look like. Impossible for this insect to transmit the bacteria, to fly or transmit the bacteria. And last thing is the gene editing or CRISPR. Everybody know now or think about the CRISPR. But in order to do CRISPR, we need to have a media to hatch the eggs inside the media. So the newborn, the small first instar of nymph can acquire the nucleic acid material and we can start to have the CRISPR. And here is just to show how the insect feed, that's actually through the media. So inside the media, we can put the genetic material. We have successful trial here with AWD with CRISPR, but, and here you can see, cannot move. You can, even if we move the tree hard, the insect cannot move. So that's actually so far what I wanted to talk about today. And by that, I thank you and I thank my team, my collaborator, and I'm happy to have any questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Kedini, for a very interesting presentation. Any question or any comments?
Well, if there are no any questions, that's mean you guys really liked my work or you really disliked my work. So
which strategy are you close to?
Well, I always believe that there are no single strategy can solve the problem. I always think that we should not leave the traditional ways we know about it, like using insecticides and this kind of stuff. We need to collaborate. We need to get together. We need to have a team to put a strategy together, having some innovative ideas and the traditional ways. And we should also have economists in our team in order to think about the cost, because as a scientist, I don't think so much about the cost. While it's very important, if we solve the problem with cost more than the cost of the production, so in this case, we didn't do anything. Concerning the pesticides, we also target some detoxification enzymes, and we have now a project for P450, the cytochrome, and we showed that we can reduce we can increase the susceptibility of insects, of psyllids, to different pesticides. And we're just working in this project in collaboration with Lukas Stereniski. And hopefully by that, we can have kind of strategy of RNAi and pesticide. That's what I'm talking about. We should have complicated strategy. Complicated problems should be fixed by complicated strategies. That is what I think. Yeah.
For those who are interested in CEUs, please send me your email address and your license number and name, and we will take care of it. One more chance for questions. Okay, thank you again, Dr. Kellini. It looks like
thank you so much for you.
Thank you, Allison.
You are so welcome, Manji.
Thank you all for your participation. And we will see you next month. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.